This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video describes how to use the internal rate of return, or often referred to as IRR, method to evaluate long-term investments. If you haven't already looked at my net present value video, you should look at that first before we get into this method, as this relates very closely to the net present value method. So the internal rate of return does consider the time value of money. That's an important element of the internal rate of return, and it represents the time-adjusted rate of return. Time-adjusted meaning it can be over a long period of time, and we have to figure out what those dollars are worth today and what that rate looks like today in today's dollars. So it's the time-adjusted rate of return for the investment that's being considered. And these are long-term investments. These are investments over, say, 5 or 10 years. Things like consideration of building a manufacturing facility somewhere. And does it make sense to do that? The internal rate of return is the rate required to get the net present value to zero. So again, take a look at the net present value video to see how that's done. And then what we're doing here is trying to find the rate that is needed to get a net present value of zero. And we'll talk about that further a little bit later. If the internal rate of return, it's stated as a rate, if the internal rate of return, the IRR, is greater than the company's required rate of return, then we accept the investment. We would take it on. If the internal rate of return is less than the company's required rate of return, then we would reject the investment. So how do we calculate the internal rate of return? Most managers do use some kind of spreadsheet software such as Excel to calculate the internal rate of return, but we can also use trial and error, and we'll talk about that here so you get a better sense of what's going on. I always say it's good to know what's going on in that black box in that software. So we're going to take a look at doing this through trial and error so you see exactly how the internal rate of return is determined. The goal, as I stated earlier, is to find the rate that generates a net present value. So we're trying to find the rate that generates a net present value of zero. And then once we have the rate, we might do this for multiple projects. And if those projects, probably we weed out the projects that have an internal rate of return that's greater than our company's required rate of return. And then once we do that and we see the acceptable projects, we might use the internal rate of return to rank those projects. So maybe our, for example, required rate of return is 10%, and we have a project that we expect after finding the internal rate of return to have an IRR of, let's say, 14%. Maybe there's another project that has an IRR of 16%, another one that has 25%. So we might use those rates also to rank those investments. It doesn't mean we're going to necessarily pick the highest, the one that has the highest internal rate of return, but it's a consideration for us. Here's an example that we will use to determine the internal rate of return and then ultimately to determine whether we want to take on this long-term investment. This is the exact same example that I used for the net present value example. So again, go take a look at that video before you watch this one and you'll see the same information and you'll have a better sense of what we're trying to accomplish here for the internal rate of return. The example is we are Jackson's Quality Copies. We make copies for customers, among other things, and we're looking at purchasing a new copy machine. Our required rate of return, this is very important, our required rate of return as a company is 10%. And I talked again in the previous, in the net present value video about how to determine the required rate of return. So we've already done that, and if we have a project that yields a return, an internal rate of return, higher than 10%, then we will go ahead and take it on. But if it's lower than 10%, we won't. So that's our required rate of return. Here are the cash flows. We're going to pay $50,000 for this new copier. It's going to last about 7 years. Annual maintenance costs will be $1,000 a year, and then labor cost savings will be $11,000 a year. And we plan to sell this copier at the end of 7 years, probably get a new one at that point. So we plan to sell this copier at the end of 7 years for $5,000. These are our cash flows, and let's map this out then on the next slide and determine what our internal rate of return is. Now the goal is to find the rate that will yield a net present value of zero, or approximately zero. This is going to be through trial and error. In Excel, we could find the exact rate, but here we'll just find an approximation. Again, take a look at the net present value lecture that I've posted. That will give you much more information on how to find the net present value, so I'm not going to focus on that here. This is more about how to find the internal rate of return, assuming that you know how to find already the net present value. So what you see here, we are finding the internal rate of return. What you see here is the net present value calculation using three different rates. So the first rate is 10%, and the net present value is positive at 1,250 with a rate of 10%. Again, we're trying to get the net present value as close to zero as possible, and whatever rate is required to do that then becomes our internal rate of return. So we're going to raise the rate because we want the net present value to go down, right? It's positive here at 10%. And again, this is trial and error. We just happen to start with 10%. So we're going to raise the rate and see what our net present value is, knowing that the net present value will go down from that 1,250 positive number. Then we go to 11%. We try 11%, and that gives us a net present value number that is negative at 469. And what that means is that the internal rate of return is somewhere between these two rates, between 10% and 11%, because at 10% our net present value is $1,250 positive, and at 11% our net present value is $469 negative. So our internal rate of return, remember, is the rate required to get a net present value of zero, and you'll see that we are very close. It's somewhere in between here. It's somewhere in between 10 and 11%. As a result, from this analysis, we can say that the internal rate of return is between 10% and 11%. And that's the best we can do right now using trial and error and the tables that are typically provided in a managerial accounting textbook. The final step here then is to compare the internal rate of return to the company's required rate of return, often called a hurdle rate. And the company, as I mentioned on the previous slide, the company's required rate of return is 10%. Since this project is expected to yield an internal rate of return that's higher than that, between 10 and 11%, we as a company would go ahead and accept this investment. If the rate happened to be, internal rate of return happened to be lower than 10%, then we would reject this investment.